We're very much honored to have with us Mr. Samir Abbas, Egyptologist, to tell us more about the life of Tawsert. Very good morning to you.
Good morning, Heather. Good morning, Rasha.
Good morning.
So, glad to be with you today. So, another episode about the ruling queens in ancient Egypt.
Yes.
So, we were covering that for almost like 5 episodes so far, and we still have two episodes to go today. Today, which is Tawsert, and the last episode, hopefully, that will be Cleopatra, the famous one, the second.
Now, we'd like to start first by her lineage and the talks about being married to Siptah or not, because there are talks, is she related, is she not, did she rule during his time, did she act as co-regent, or did she rule after his death because of the period of her ruling? There are debate about whether she entered her reign with his or not. So what's the truth?
We went straight into the depths of the subject.
Yeah,
you know,
so tell us a bit about her.
First of all, in order to, like, why we choose her, first of all, Tawsert is not one of these famous queens. Mm-hmm. So we hear about Hatshepsut, Nefertari, Nefertiti, Cleopatra, but how do we hear about Tawsert? So maybe because there is not much recorded history, there is not much buildings, achievements, which is well known for people, for her. But the reason why I choose her, because there is a possible connection between her and the famous Exodus, which is the flee of the escape of the Israelites from Egypt. We know that's a very big topic, which is we might dedicate another episode to talk about the Exodus, Ramesses, and the connection with kings of the 18 or 19 dynasty. But there is a possible connection between this queen and the Exodus. So about the period when she ruled, 19 dynasty, exactly as you mentioned, more specific, the end of the 19th dynasty, almost 1202. BC, and she ruled almost for 8 years, which is not for a short period of time. So not just for a year or two as an exceptional rule. So third, she was a ruling queen, and that we have a very strong evidence that she was practicing leadership. Her name was written in hieroglyphics inside Hartouche. So her monuments actually has been found, not many, but in different places. And the interesting thing that not only in Egypt, there is relics, or there is like potteries and statues has been found very as far as Jordan, Palestine, and as far as Nubia. So which is mean that she was not only actually ruling Egypt, she was ruling actually other territories around as well. So she is important as well because she ruled even in a very crucial time. There is a very big economical or disorder in the country in that time. And that's why it could be associated with the Exodus and what happens after the Exodus as well. So there is lots of reasons actually why we choose her subject today, and not forgetting that her tomb in the Valley of the Kings, not in the Valley of the Queens, and considered the longest tomb, 112 meters. We will talk about that as well. So now I will come.
Yeah, because you saw the amazement on my face. Why in the Valley of the Kings, not the Valley of the
Queens? She was a ruling queen. And back in that time, when she ruled, she had the title of the pharaoh, like a male title, like Hatshepsut. Hatshepsut, her tomb's in the Valley of the Kings as well.
Yes.
So, and then going back actually to your point, is about her lineage, her husband, and it's very obvious that she was from a pure royal blood. And her first husband was Merenptah, and possibly she is married to Siptah as well, and then Seti the second, which is, that's another exceptional story. We have a lady which is married from three different kings at the end of the 19th dynasty.
She outlived the Mona.
That's more like a feminine looking as a story, right?
Is that possible to be married to
Each one of them died, actually, right. not all in the same time. So you know, she was married to Merenptah until he died. He ruled almost for 10 years, then Siptah, and then after his death she married a young king, actually. Seti the second, he was a young, and he died very young as well, and his rule was short, and he hardly left any monuments behind. So that takes us to another subject, is that the transition of power. She had a pure royal blood, and she was the connection. She was the one which has made those kings be kings, and that also gave her a tremendous experience in politics and running the country, because she was in the royal palace for a very long time, and that's why when there is a problems happening at the end of the 19th dynasty after the early death, of Seti II, which is possibly because of, possibly he is the pharaoh of the Exodus, if we came to, so that is like, that's like a diagram of showing the Exodus and Moses leading the Israelites outside of Egypt, which is a very controversial topic. But the interesting thing that, you know, both in the Old Testament and the Muslim holy book, the Quran, there is a very interesting quote about there was disasters, there was famines, and there was plague. Plagues happens in Egypt, and that is going along with the period of Siptah and Seti II, which is, that's why Seti II, he could be one of the pharaohs or the last pharaohs involved in the Exodus. It is not right to say that Ramesses II, or he was the pharaoh of the Exodus, because talking about the Exodus and Moses, he lived for nearly 150 years, and Ramesses II, he didn't rule actually for that long. He ruled for like 67 years, which is mean that we have more than one pharaoh involved in the Exodus. From my personal perspective, I'm not saying that I know for sure, but that's another theory, another opinion, that possibly Seti II, he is the last pharaoh of the Exodus, the famous one, the one who chased the Israelites, and that's why he died very early and very young, and he left no achievements, and there was lots of political problems after their time, and she ruled actually after Seti II's death. That was 12-2.
So we can move to the next photograph?
Sure. So we have other illustration, which is showing here. That was also another striking figure for her. Her name, by the way, you know, I forget to tell you about her name. So she picked a very powerful name. Actually, that's the name itself, that's her. So the name itself, Ta Usrit, means the strong one, the powerful one. The word Usr or Wisr in the ancient Egyptian language means powerful and strong. So, and she picked the name to refer that she can run the country as a strong man. And that's that. I think that happens. Unfortunately, some of the army leaders didn't like the idea, and that's why he took over her power, which is Setnacht, an army leader, which is, he could possibly also have other backgrounds as well, but, and that was making the end of her reign. But we will talk about that in details later on. So Ta Usrit is another exceptional figure in Egyptian in Egyptian history. Ta Usrit is another lady, which is, she took responsibility and she managed to perform her task in a very high level. She managed, she was around actually many kings, she learned from them, and she was able to run the country for 8 years, which is not a short time, and until things turned not to be actually right for her.
So, now, I'm quite curious, because there are talks that actually her time might have been a time of revolution, as you've mentioned, and there are debate about, among Egyptologists. Some say, no, her reign was stable, and that's why we could see evidence of her in the north and south, and the lavish tomb and funerary temple. Others say, no, she was despised, and that's why later on her name was obliterated, and even her successors of the 20th dynasty, in their list, they removed her name of the list. Which opinion are you more for?
So first of all, you know, so talking about her period, I think that she faced big challenges. If it is right that this period is a period where the Exodus happens, and there was lots of plagues, lots of disasters happens, which has damaged the infrastructure of the country, which is agriculture in that time. So she will have a serious problem in running the country. To stay in power for 8 years and to leave some monuments here and there, and to have a very beautiful tomb like KV14 in the Valley of the Kings, and have also Mortuary Temple, which is under excavation now in the West Bank of Luxor next to Ramesseum Temple. She had some quite good achievements, both for the 8 years according to the economical situation of the time. That's how we should judge the rule, the pharaohs back in that time, because it's not fair to compare her with Ramesses II, a king who ruled for 67 years. And he left a countless number of monuments, and the country was very rich in his time. So she faced lots of challenges, and from my personal perspective, that she was, based on the challenges she has, she was able to accomplish actually things. So normally when I take a groups or people which had a deep interest in in art in ancient Egypt, that is the beginning. So I like to show them first Ta Usrit tomb. At the end of the Valley of the Kings, you have to hike all the way at the end of the valley. She picked a very special place, a quiet place at the end of the valley. It is the longest tomb in the Valley of the Kings, 112 meters. Okay, so the reason why it is called KV14, by the way, the reason why I like to take people there first, because honestly, if we don't have time to see other tombs in the Valley of the Kings, that mm-hmm. could be enough. Mm-hmm. Her tomb is big, had a very detailed decorations, mm-hmm. has very well preserved conditions. Mm-hmm. The colors is really good, and the most important that it is unfinished.
Mm-hmm. Why?
So, because this lady, you know, so her reign didn't end properly, like normal, you know. So, her power was taken away from her by Setnacht.
Oh, okay. There was a coup against her.
Exactly, was like a coup. So, and that
she time to finish
her tomb. You know, so of course, there's lots of theories about that. She might have a natural death, but it possibly that, you know, that this guy who took the power away from her. Not only, mm-hmm. you know, the reason that why I believe that there was something happens, like a coup happens, because he took her tomb as well. Satnik took her tomb and widening or extending the size of the tomb, building a new burial chamber, and declaring her tomb as his own burial, his own tomb. And he plastered over her hieroglyphics and her names and putting his name on it. Mm-hmm. And he didn't live long enough to finish his tomb, by the way. So why it is very important, it is unfinished and important, because in the finished tombs, you don't know how things happens, how the process of how the ancient Egyptian artists managed to accomplish these beautiful drawings. But when you find unfinished buildings or unfinished tombs, normally for archaeologists is more important than the finished one, because they leave their tools behind, they leave their techniques behind. So in the unfinished part, you can tell that, you know, the different stages, and I can easily explain all of the different stages of cutting, smoothing, paintings, and decorating based on that. So the art, it's first, as I mentioned earlier, that is one of the very well-preserved mm-hmm. tombs when it comes to the art, especially her burial chamber, which is very richly decorated. Yeah. So in the picture number actually disappeared now. In number seven, actually, it is the most beautiful mm-hmm. Scene there in the tomb, which is showing a god with two wings mm-hmm. and with a ram head, which is a mix. Yes, yeah. Mix of bird and ram, and that is represent the god Amun, mm-hmm. Amun Ra, and mm-hmm. During the sunset, mm-hmm. and that is the most common scene in the Valley of the Kings, because all of
sunset
the kings.
Sunset represents death.
Yes, that's very good. Yeah, thanks, Hala, for pointing that out. So, sunset represents death. So, because every ancient Egyptian person and king as well, they like to associate themselves with the sun. When the sun dies or sets,
sunrise means birth and sunset.
Exactly. So, they associate themselves with the cycle. And that's why the most common figure of Amun Ra in the Valley of the Kings is the one with the ram head, which is represent the setting of the sun. Yes. So, but another
it's
one.
It's like an orange circle.
So the orange circle, which is on the top of that, represents the noontime.
Okay.
The scarab beetles represent the early morning, the birds. Mm. And then the man with a ram head or a bird with a ram head represent the sunset. So in this picture, you have the whole cycle of the sun. From birth, you can see even the hands, you know, delivering the birth, mm. the scarab beetle, then the sun disk, then Amun-Ra
I'm quite curious about the artistic style, because once you enter the tomb, the beginning, it's sculpted and it's relief. But by the time you reach the burial chamber, then it's plastered and painted. Is that because they were in a hurry? But yet the reliefs are very beautiful, or was that common at that time?
So there is more than one reason to change, actually, into mm-hmm. that. So one of the reasons is the rock quality. Mm-hmm. If the rock quality is good enough, so they will go for carvings, because they know that the wall will not disintegrate when mm-hmm. they start carvings. But in the inner part, if the rock quality is not good enough, and mm-hmm. so they will go for paintings or plastering them over and carving on plaster or painting on plaster. Mm-hmm. So another reason that this lady was in rush, mm-hmm. she was around already three different kings. She was in power and married to three different kings. And she knew that she don't have that much time. And that's why in the innermost part, maybe she's getting sick, she's getting very old, and she realized that she cannot stay for longer, and that switched into the paintings in the innermost part, and she couldn't finish that as well. Even we can see the drawings of the artist, because there was different classes mm-hmm. of artists, which is the supervisors, they will come with a different color and make the correction on the scenes before being carved as well. I would like to address a very sensitive actually topics about mm-hmm. about women rule in ancient Egypt. Mm-hmm. So it seemed that generally speaking that the community in that time, or it was a little bit biased against the women to be in power. which is, we have many examples of many queens became into power, became ruling queens, and they did very well, like Hatshepsut, like Ta Usrit, and others as well. But it happened that most of their names has been chiseled out, has been covered. They have been erased from the history. So there was a chance in the ancient Egyptian history for a lady to be the queen, to be the ruling queen, actually, of the country, as a pharaoh. But very few of them, they have very less chance to have their names survived after that, because the mainstream of the other kings didn't like the idea. That's one thing. Another thing, which is when it comes to the ruling queens in ancient Egypt, I think even there was few of them which is ruled in ancient Egypt, the few which is we know about. Remember that we already, we depends on the ancient Egyptian reference as our main source of information, and which is mean that those who survived left some monuments which is not being chiseled out or not being completely erased. It could be double the number of other queens we don't know anything about. Or it could be there is new excavations will reveal some other queens to do that. So we still don't know all of them. So, but even compared to the ancient world in that time, and the rule of the woman in Egypt compared to the woman in the ancient world, the rule of the woman in ancient Egypt was very superior compared to the women's elsewhere. So,
how many women rulers?
So, which is like five or six, which is we know about that for sure that they ruled in ancient Egypt. But from my personal perspective,
there could be
like
more
which we
don't
know. Yes,
now,
exactly.
I'm very curious as we're wrapping it to talk about her mummy, because her mummy was moved, and it's interesting that when they did the keshet and preserved other kings' mummies. Hers was not well kept, and now there are rumors about certain mummies, whether it's hers or not, and it's actually only through the mummification process. How do you see that?
So that's proof my point about that there was some bias against women rule in ancient Egypt. So when they were in power, everybody respected them. When they were in power, they were able to enforce the rules and their history and their tomb, their buildings. But after their deaths, some of the kings, they will prefer, they would like to keep the history, they would like to keep the respect. But in the long period of time, you will find that there is one or two kings in the long period of time which they don't appreciate of a woman came to power, and they will remove their names, and they will not even treat the mummy in a proper way because they don't want the history for this lady to survive, so it will not encourage other women to come in power. It has something to do with the ancient Egyptian mythology as well, because in the ancient Egyptian mythology, Horus, which is the legendary king of Egypt, and he is the prototype of the kings, of the leadership of Egypt, he's a man. And so for a woman to rule, that's again is the ancient Egyptian religion. So
unless she would claim that she is the son of the god, the daughter of the god, for example, like what...
You know, so all of them, they made up
the
stories about their divine birth. So our next episode, hopefully, will be about Cleopatra, and I'll have a serious problem to wrap Cleopatra's story in one, like in 20 minutes. But
maybe you could dedicate two episodes.
We'll see.
Thank you very much, Samir Abbas, Egyptologist, for being with us today and telling us more about this interesting queen in ancient Egypt.
Unknown, and the unknown one.
The unknown one. Thank you very much. We can't wait for the upcoming episode where you're going to tell us about Cleopatra. So stay tuned for that.